Honorable Member Tathagat Satpathy Ji.
Sir, thank you for giving me this opportunity. Let me start. The High Court and the Supreme Court judges, salaries and conditions of service, Amendment Bill 2015. Sir, the statement of objects and reasons is interesting to read. The very first paragraph has two lines, which is very relevant. With the passage of time, certain provisions in the aforesaid acts have become spent and outdated. Next, it comes to another line, the last line of the first paragraph. Some of the provisions relating to determination of leave allowances of judges in both the acts, that means High Court and Supreme Court, both the acts needed to be simplified. We all know that the birth of this bill took place because the Supreme Court asked the government to review the salaries and the pensions, more so of the pensions of the Supreme Court judges. Sir, we all know that our judiciary is under tremendous strain. I am not sitting in judgment of the judiciary. They are judging all of us. And they are even judging the House, which is the voice of the people, by decrying or by negating the NJAC. It is not only a slap on the government or the House, it is a slap on the people of this country, on the face of the people of this country. It's a very sad event, and all of us are concerned, those who think for this country, because it is not just those few judges who took the decision, it is a mindset which is gaining predominance in this country. Sir, there is no doubt that judges should get very, very well paid. That is the only way you can stop all these rumors and all these falsified claims that are circulating in the open society today that our judges are corrupt. These false things must be put to an end. Our judges, nobody can claim that our judges are corrupt. So it hurts all of us when we hear that from the junior most judiciary up to the highest, the apex court, the rich, the wealthy, and those who have reach, who have the power, they get away with everything. I remember some publication had published that when a big industrialist, his name featured in this Neera Radia tapes, he went to the Supreme Court on a Monday saying that no further leakages should be permitted of the tapes. And the hearing took place on a Wednesday of that same week, and the judgment came out that same Friday, that week's Friday, the last day of working day. And the judgment said that we stop all publication of further leakages of Neera Radia tapes involving this very well-known big industrialist of Bombay. Interestingly, the next day, two magazines, Close and Inward Looking, they published further data on the Neera Radia tapes. So two things came to mind of the public and to me as a humble citizen of this country, that people have reached a stage where they wish to defy the Supreme Court just because the Supreme Court did not give a judgment that was acceptable to the people. So in a democracy, people are definitely supreme. Here we are addressing a problem, as far as I understand this bill, it's a slightly complex problem. There are two streams through which people are coming up as judges. One is from the junior judiciary, subordinate judiciary. They are coming up from the JMFC, SDJM, CJM, district judge. Then they become high court judges with seniority. There are other judges who do not climb the tree, but pluck the fruit from the top of the tree. And they come up, because of certain other abilities, like they are good practitioners in the bar, their income tax returns are good, and therefore they come straight up without going through the grind. They come straight up and enter the high courts, or sometimes they even probably do so at a higher level. The problem that we can perceive is that, let us assume a young LLB pass person who could have very easily joined the bar, and maybe he would have excelled as a lawyer, made a neat package, and would have lived a happy life. Instead, in a very contorted manner, he joins the judicial services, kind of, in inverted commas I am saying, sir, kind of he sacrifices his youth to dispense justice, becomes a judge or becomes a magistrate and then a judge. And we expect absolute honesty, absolute efficiency, and we think that he will dispense with justice because the subordinate judiciary is the real justice dispensing system that touches the real people. So to give him credit, in the present situation, without this amendment, he was getting a higher pension when he retired, a higher pension than his compatriot who joined the judicial service at a higher level because of his ability or because of his practice as a good lawyer or because of his influence. Some godfather picked him up and made him a judge, which we also know has happened in many high courts. Now this bill tries to equate them by not making this line which has come up through the grind go up, but instead adding 10 years as bonus service period for that judge who has not come through the grind. This, I personally feel, is unequal and unjust. In a justice system, you cannot do something which is unjust to those young people who join the judicial services. Just because they did not practice, or just because they do not have a godfather at a higher level, does not mean they should be deprived of the pensionary advantage which they have over somebody who has made a lot of money while being in private practice. This Salaries and Conditions of Service Amendment Bill should have also taken into account that why not make the central government pay the salaries of the High Court judges and the Supreme Court judges. So now what happens? Suppose the Honorable Minister's state of Karnataka sends a Chief Justice to Orissa, and the gentleman or the gentlelady retires from service as the Chief Justice of Orissa, then his or her salary or his or her pension will be a burden on the state of Orissa. So instead of burdening states with a service that you think is all India level, because Chief Justices are transferable across states, the government should take up the responsibility, because they are not IAS officers, they do not have a state cadre. So the government of India should take up the responsibility of paying the pension. While they are in service, the salaries can be paid for by the relevant state, but their pension should be borne by the central government. If you do that, then what you do as Salaries and Conditions of Service Amendment Bill will be much more acceptable to the people. We were given by one honorable member earlier, last time that we were discussing this bill, an example. No, sir, I just started, sir.
Only 6 minutes are there.
Sir, okay, I'll come to a few points and I will wind up. Sir, there is a saying in English, give peanuts and you get samians. So, sir, let us not give such low salaries to our honorable judges that they are tempted to go into acts which are not acceptable to society. Sir, high courts
of the country, 24 high courts have 44.5 lakh pending cases. The lower courts across the country have 2.6 crores of pending cases. Sir, most of these cases, if you see, out of these, sir, most of them will be civil cases. If out of 44 lakhs pending in the high courts, sir, in the 24 high courts, 34,32,493 are civil cases and 10,23,739 cases are criminal cases. So my suggestion is that come up with bills such as the Uniform Civil Code, whereby lot of these civil cases could be dispensed off with speed and justice could be meted out to the people, and those who are in need of immediate justice will be better off. Because again, to refer to an old adage, justice denied is justice delayed. In India, many of our lawyer colleagues believe that justice delayed is justice delivered. Because, sir, the more number of dates, the better it is for a section of the people. Time is also the best healer. And lot of lawyers, lawyer colleagues here, sir, I do not think the chair is a lawyer. Therefore, I am saved by you. Thank you so much. But lot of our lawyer colleagues here would be very perturbed that this is a court that does not suit anybody. So I beg pardon from them. But sir, I think that simplification of the law is the first primary responsibility of the government of India. The second is that the subordinate judiciary in this country must be strengthened, and the jobs, because sir, government jobs are no more attractive. Nobody wants to get to government jobs unless what they call in Oriya, upuri. Matlab upar se, if something is not dropping from this dome, sir, over and above, sir, it is no more attractive. Sir, you are a man of the field. You go to the people and you see the plight of the people when they have to, a case filed against a family, sir, destroys the whole family, destroys the peace, destroys their economy. This happens only in India because our justice delivery system has collapsed at the lower level. Sir, high courts and especially the Supreme Court is inaccessible to most people. Sir, if you go to the states and if you find out from those who are convicted and are in jail, sir, many of them have been jailed at the SDJM level, at the most at the district judge level. They do not have the wherewithals, they do not have the financial prowess, the strength to come up to the high courts. So forget the Supreme Court. So at that level, we have to address the problems of the subordinate judiciary, make that stronger, make that more attractive, so that you can demand that if you are getting better pay, do not accept inducements and be honest and be speedy and deliver justice at a pace that will amaze this same country. And I think this government, sir, this minister is a progressive minister. He is a thorough gentleman. I do not know, they took him out of railways. I was hoping a lot that he would do wonders in the railways. But sir, he is a man who can actually change this system. Here is an example, sir. And you can do it. We have full confidence. And I am sure the House will back you if you think about the subordinate judiciary and bring about changes. And no matter who shouts, sir, we will support you if you bring in changes. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.